Father, we thank you for this morning, Lord, as we come together to worship your name, Father. Lord, we're so eternally grateful for your blessings that you bestow upon this congregation, Father. I pray that you would embolden us this morning with your Spirit and your Word, Lord. I pray for our pastor this morning, Father, that he brings forth a message on your behalf. Father, we just pray that this morning is a time that is glorifying to you. In Jesus' name. Take a moment, hug, and shake hands.
Thank you. Come up and sing a song. hear me, so as long as you can hear me, it's good. Last week I was talking to some of our winter visitors who come to worship with us so faithfully all winter, and they were leaving right away. So I thought, since I've been doing the music, it's really hard to get up here and sing a song too. So today we're trying to do it. That's why not everything worked perfectly. We're here to worship and make a joyful noise. So this is a song for the winter people who are flying north. It's called All the Love I Count. And I don't count on my fingers.
When I think about all the friends that I have left behind, the love they poured out on me, the times they were so kind, they may seem like they're so far away, but when I look inside I find all the love I count on is still there. Someday soon we'll all be home together. Someday soon we'll meet the Father there.
This is terrible.
Won't be long, I'll be right there with Jesus in the home that He's prepared for us in that great somewhere. The world could seem so harsh and cold, I sometimes feel left out.
I'm not going to get real frustrated. I'm going to sing the song without the guitar, okay?
The world can seem so harsh and cold, I sometimes feel left out. The problems of this mundane world can make me scream and shout. I'm so thankful for the Lord and you, I can be sure about. And all the love I count on is still there. And someday soon we'll all be home together. Someday soon we'll meet the Father there. Well, it won't be long, we'll be right there with Jesus in that home that He's prepared for us in that great somewhere. If the worst I could imagine was happening to me, if I failed so bad that all my friends just turned their backs on me, even then, through all the tears, Jesus' love I'd see, and all the love I count on would still be there. And someday soon we'll all be home together. Someday soon we'll meet the Father there. Well, it won't be long, we'll be right there with Jesus in that home that He's prepared for us, in that great somewhere, in that place that He's prepared for us, in that great somewhere.
Okay, let's do our announcements, Jerry. We'll go ahead and do those. Sunday School, Isaiah, How to Make Choices You Won't Forget, two classes taught by two of the elders. Sunday evenings, I'm teaching still on the transformed life of Saul. Wednesday evenings, I'm teaching on the Antichrist out of 2 Thessalonians 2. If you'd like to help, wasn't praise and worship great this morning? Great. If you want to help with that, see Doug or Gordon. CareNet, we're looking for liaisons between the church and the possibility of a CareNet pregnancy center being opened in Benson. CareNet is a Christian alternative to some of the other solutions there are in the world for young ladies that are getting ready to have babies. If you'd like to volunteer for that, just see me. We don't pass the plate at New Life. We have an agape box. Your giving is between you and the Lord, so you can use that if you so desire. Save the date on April 1st and the 22nd of April at Community Bible Church. They will be making stockings already for Christmas for disadvantaged families. You can participate on that. Next Sunday night, as is our MO, we'll have after the evening service, we'll go to Wendy's and eat. And then you can see the plate right there. We will not have a hospitality meeting on the 2nd of April. We're going to skip that and get ready for our big, big Resurrection Sunday brunch. New Ladies Bible Study starts on Tuesday, April 4th at 9:30. Lord, Give Me a Heart for You, an inductive Bible study by Kay Arthur. Community service on Palm Sunday. We will not meet here at 6:30. We will meet at Benson High School at 6 p.m. for community-wide service. Our praise and worship group will be doing the music for that. And then on Resurrection Sunday at 6 a.m. in the Ramada in the back, we will have our sunrise service. And we have a brunch after the service. And there's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. If you're not sure what to bring, bacon. Bacon. There you go. You can never, let me tell you, you can never go wrong bringing bacon, all right? And so that list is out there. Please sign up so we know what people are bringing. And then in preparation for VBS, we need painters. We have one painter here, but we need painters to help with the backdrops. And they are meeting on Tuesdays at 11, Thursdays at 9. And if you need any more information, just see Mary. She's the lovely lady sitting next to rather ordinary Paul. Just helping my brother out today. No, that's not my joke. But I do have a few jokes for you. These are all questions that you've asked yourself numerous times as you've gone through life. They're all why questions. Why is abbreviated such a long word? I'm sorry, Sparky. Why is it what doctors and attorneys do called a practice? All right, that's a little better. All right. Why is the man who invests all your money called a broker? Why don't sheep shrink when it rains? Then last, and thankfully last, if flying is so safe, why do they call the airport the terminal? I'll be in Vegas next week at the Sand. Doug, I need a drum roll next time when I get done. Okay, so this morning we have a special guest speaker. This is Sparky. Come here, Sparky. Sparky's going to speak to us about CMA. I met Sparky at a Ministerial Alliance meeting, and I thought, that's a rather odd fellow. He's just like me. I think I like him. And so we've got to know each other a little bit. He's been working at the church just about ever since I met him. And I appreciate his heart for ministry. I have known numerous individuals associated with the Christian Motorcycle Association. Are there any of those people here? Have any of you? Mary's raising her hand. I think John may have been. Paul. Several of you. Yeah, there's John in the back. And I've had some dear friends back in Clovis, New Mexico that were associated with them. And another thing, I have to say something about Sparky's dad, Archie. How many of you knew Archie? Archie worked with the Gideons in this area for years. I don't know how many.
Over 50.
And, you know, when we started this work, some people were very happy. Some people weren't so happy. And I remember Archie showing up at the door one day. And what a heart for the Lord. This is a special, special guy. So I don't say that to bring everybody down. I say that to raise everybody up, because you can feel some of the same heart in Sparky. So I've given him 10 minutes. And if he goes 1 second over, I'm yanking him off. So. Are you ready? All right, brother. God bless you. And you're on.
Good morning. I promise I will keep this short. Thank you very much. Pastor Steve, the kind words about my father. He was my hero. I had a lot of living, a lot of things that I've done in my life, of course, that I'm not proud of, but one of the single biggest things that I'm proud of is that I got involved with the CMA, the Christian Motorcyclists Association. And I got involved with them the day I got called to the ministry was the day God called my father home. And I realized that I put the motorcycle in front of God, and that it was my way, my out, that I would go and ride the motorcycle. And I wasn't going to church, and I wasn't serving him. I wasn't a bad person. I was just kind of coasting for that day when Christ returned or I got called home. I wasn't living for him. I offered to sell that motorcycle, and I told God that I would serve him, how he would have me serve. And it wasn't 30 minutes after I prayed that prayer that God told me, I want you to keep that motorcycle, but I want you to serve me on it. And I got involved with the CMA. And I really appreciate this time this morning to talk to you. What I'm here for is I'd like to talk to you guys about, we're looking for support from local churches in several ways. First of all, to pray for us. What we do, our ministry, the Christian Motorcyclists Association, we minister primarily to bikers. And yes, that element, that 1% that are the bad people, the bad of the bad, that is who we minister to. We go where they go. When they have rallies, we have booths there. We tell them, we're here if you need us. And we have a very effective ministry. We've earned the right to be with these bikers, and they trust us. And when things go wrong, they call on the CMA to come and pray with them and to minister to them. We reach annually, and it's a conservative number, about 14,000 bikers annually accept Christ as their Savior. We also have our Run for the Sun as our annual fundraiser. In your bulletins, there is a flyer if you guys want to follow along. We give 60% of the funds that we collect, we give away to three other ministry partners that we have partnered up with. We keep 40%. That goes, all of the funds go directly to ministry. None of it goes to supporting any payroll or anything with the CMA. All of the funds that we collect, Run for the Sun, goes to ministry. And 60% that we give away, the first one that I'd like to talk about is Missionary Ventures. What they do is they take the money that we give them, they buy motorcycles, cars, goats, or not goats, camels, boats, any sort of transportation that indigenous pastors would need out in, like, say, South America, for example. If they need like a dual sport motorcycle or a horse, or any type of transportation need, they will take the monies and buy the transportation needs. Then they will have select members of the CMA go down and present the pastors with these things. We end up spending 2 weeks there in the mission field when we go, and that is what Missionary Ventures is all about, that we're basically there to help indigenous pastors in foreign countries. Another one of our ministry partners is Open Doors, and what they're about, they primarily minister to persecuted Christians, which Christians are the largest persecuted religious group on the planet. Regardless of what you may hear, that we are persecuted. And just professing that you're a Christian in some countries can cost you your very life. And that is what Open Doors does, is they minister to those Christians. They help educate and teach and support the Christians in these countries where they are oppressed. They also take Bibles into countries where the Gideons do not go into. So to date, 2.5 million copies of the Word of God have been given out through Open Doors, which compared to the Gideons is not much, but it is still an effective ministry. Last but certainly not least is the one that I am the most passionate about, is the Jesus Film Project. And I save them for last because they report, each one of our ministry partners reports to us at the end of the year, the start of every year, what all has been going on in their ministry. Jesus Film Project, we were able, with the funds we raised last year, we were able to donate to each one of our ministry partners $869,000 last year. A personal goal of mine, I would like to be able to see that we were able to give each of them $1 million this year. And the reason being, Jesus Film Project reported back to the CMA the first of this year that for $869,000, 10 people worldwide, for every dollar they got from the CMA, got to see the Jesus Film Project. And what that Jesus Film Project is, they go to these villages where they've never even heard of electricity. They will set up a tent, they will have generators, and they have the Jesus film, which depicts the life of Christ and has the plan of salvation into the movie. And it is in their native language, over 1,500 languages that this movie is produced in. So out of those 10 people that get to see that every year, out of 869,000 times 10, they reported to us that 2 people accepted Christ as their Savior. So, myself, if we could give them $1 million, that's potentially 2 million people potentially can receive Christ as their Savior in this coming year. So, if anybody feels led, if you would like to talk to me about, maybe you feel led that you would like to get involved in our ministry, you don't have to ride to get involved with the CMA. If you do ride and you would like to get involved with the ministry, or you would just like to ride with fellow Christians, please see me after the service. Please remember to pray for the CMA and the CMA's ministry partners. If you would like to sponsor me in the Run for the Sun, get with me after the service. I have the forms here that you can sponsor me. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you for your support. And this church has been a huge blessing to me. Pastor Steve, thank you so much for the kind words about my father also. God bless you.
Okay. So, like Sparky said, he'll be in the foyer afterwards if you'd like to talk to him. And good cause, good people, good cause. All right? So for the next few weeks, I'm going to suspend my verse-by-verse, word-by-word teaching out of the Gospel of John, and we're going to look at a topical study. And as Jerry sang of this morning, we're going to look at the topic of an everlasting love, okay? An everlasting love. And our source scriptures for this particular study are going to be in Jeremiah 31. We're going to be in Jeremiah 31. And our source verse this morning will be verse 3. Jeremiah 31, 3. If you have your Bibles, will you join me there? So let's just pause for a moment and give God his due as we open his word today. Forget about what's for lunch, although I am getting hungry. Think about what the Lord has for us to consume. The word that will never leave us hungry. And if you're ready for the word of God this morning, would you signify that by saying amen.
Amen.
And would you stand with me out of respect, if you are able, to the reading of God's word, which is a light unto our feet. Jeremiah 31:3, the Lord has appeared of old to me, saying, yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness, I have drawn you. Thank you. You can be seated. An everlasting love. You know, in our world today, in the chaos in which we live, there are many, many unknowns. But there's one thing that is not unknown, and that is the love of God. Upon that, we can rest assured. And that verse makes it very clear, when it comes to God's love, there are no conditions. There are no time limitations. There's not an expiration date. God simply says, I love you with an everlasting love. And how has he proven that to us? By the cross of Christ. Has proven that. Just as John 3:16 testifies to us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever should believe in him will not perish, but have everlasting or eternal life. So God indeed did send his Son to die and to be raised up to life for both you and for me. But you know, God sent his Son to die also for those that don't know Jesus. God sent his Son to die for those that we might not even particularly care for. You know, sometimes we can narrow God's love to our own personal sphere, to our own thinking about the way we think about God, our own friends, our own families, our own viewpoints. But God loves everyone. He even loves people that may not hold our same political viewpoints. Did you know that? Yeah. But you know, God so loved the world. And that's very written in the Greek. That's written very emphatically, and it's to be taken literally. There has not been a single solitary person who has ever lived. There is not one person today who is living, and there will never be anyone who will live on the face of the earth that God hasn't, is, and will love. And God sent his Son to die for all of them, an everlasting, far-reaching, all-encompassing love. And God has an intent for his love. Do you know what his intent for you, that his love would generate in you? A faith, a saving faith, that will then, what's the Westminster Catechism say? What is the purpose of humanity? To glorify God. Amen. That you then, because of that love, because of that expression of love that Jesus has spoken into your life, that you then will speak that love into other people's lives. An everlasting, far-reaching, all-encompassing love. And God, you know, the world is just, look at the world. Man, how confused are we? How much chaos is there? Look at the political system. It's a disaster. And you know, all of these things chip away at the foundational beliefs of Christians. Chip after chip. That's not a referral to food. And you know, a lot of us, we have concerns and we have questions, and a lot of times those things might go unanswered. But one constant that we always have is the love of God. Have you ever wondered if God has forgotten your name or your address? Have you ever had some hard times as a child of God? If you haven't, let me know, and maybe you can tell me how that works out. But hey, sometimes it feels that way. But when our faith, it's been my experience in my life, when my faith is most vulnerable. I talked about Archie. Have you ever heard of that biblical word, naysayers? You know what naysayers are? Doubters. Sometimes we can be our own worst naysayers. I remember sitting in my office one day. We were still renting this building at that time. It was still rather dilapidated. Thinking, Lord, I just don't know if this is. I know this is what you've laid on my heart, but I'm not sure if I'm the man to do this. And then I heard a knock on my door, and here comes Archie. And if you've never met Archie, just think of an overflowing, bubbling beverage. And that was Archie. And here comes Archie. By the time he left, I was more enthusiastic than he was. That was his ministry. And that's what the Lord does. You know, when we're in times of stress, when we're in times when we think, Lord, can I do this? It's been my experience. If you're faithful, He is always faithful. Always faithful. Just be faithful. Because He has that everlasting love. A love that the cross did demonstrate for us. Jeremiah 30:31 is a great chapter of the Bible. It's filled with beauty and grace. Verse 2, if you still have your fingers in there, it says, Thus says the Lord, the people who survived the sword found grace in the wilderness. What that says is that God doesn't abandon His people. Even when they find the sword, which is a symbol of discipline, even when they're in the wilderness, God's love, God's grace continues to embrace Him. But let me tell you, there's other things about Jeremiah 31 also. It contains great anguish. In verse 15, it says, A voice is heard in Ramah. Lamentation and bitter weeping. Rachel is weeping for her children. She refuses to be comforted because her children are no more. See, God's people would soon be placed into bondage by the armies of the Babylonians who would descend upon Judah. The Babylonians, when they conquered a society, they removed it. They took everybody. They took the best and took them home and incorporated them into their own society. Okay? Daniel, folks like that. Okay? There were other people. They either killed them or sold them into slavery. They burned everything they had. They destroyed everything they had. And that's the story that Jeremiah is telling the people that's coming, because they themselves had brought upon these consequences because of their idolatry. And that's the worst thing about it. When you're the one that has caused that distance to grow between you and God. Because I can tell you, God ain't going nowhere. He's here. You need to be as close to Him as you can. But sometimes, in our stubbornness, in our bitterness, we will turn and walk away. Don't do that. Stop. Allow Him to work. Feel that love in your life. You know, God's love in the darkest hours is more than equal to anything you might face. You can also hear God's declaration and His promises in that 31st verse of Jeremiah. If you look at verses 31 through 34, it says, "Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant, which they broke, though I was a husband to them, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds." Okay? "I will write my law on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For they'll all know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord. For I forgive their iniquity and their sin." This is great. "Their sin I will remember no more." That's great. See, to forgive and to forget is, humanly speaking, impossible. If somebody hurts us and hurts us deeply, if somebody sins against us, no matter what we might try to do, you know, I do a lot of family counseling. And, and I'll hear people say to each other, "Well, they can't forget what I did to them." And I'll say, "You know what? You're right. They can't. Because you cannot humanly, it's not within the human ability to forget, but they can forgive." So when people hurt us, we have the memory of that. It's written, when people hurt us, it's written in that ledger book in ink. We keep a record of those offenses by which others have offended us. And if you look in the book of Jeremiah, you see time after time after time where God's people, by their iniquities, offended Him, by their idolatries, offended Him. But through prophets such as Jeremiah, the Lord reminded them of their past. That was who they were at that time. And do you blame God? No, I don't blame God. From God's perspective, His relationship, as He said in those verses, was the equivalent of a marriage. A marriage in which the call to forgiveness. Did God forgive His people? Time after time after time. But that call to forgiveness is so important. It's what can relieve the stress in a marriage when there's hearts that have been hurt. The old covenant, the first covenant which God established on Mount Sinai, by that time in Israel's life was irreparable. It was based on God's love, was it not? He brought His people out of Egypt. But it also depended upon Israel's ability to keep the law. How did they do that at that? They didn't do very well. They couldn't do it. They wouldn't do it. And they didn't do it. Besides that, the old covenant was very narrow. It was between who? It was between the Lord and His chosen people. Okay? But the new Calvary, which is based upon Calvary's cross, the new covenant, which is based upon Calvary's cross, has no restrictions on it. God intended for it to be for all of humanity. And it was anchored, the anchor of that cross is God's love. And that love extended to God's enemies. And it was that love was fulfilled in the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That new covenant that we celebrate when we celebrate the Lord's Supper here at New Life, that new covenant changed everything. Now, new sin could be forgiven and forgotten. That's a dramatic change. You need to keep that in mind. In Jeremiah 31, 34, I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sin no more. God didn't function that way under the old covenant. God now forgives and forgets. Every hour of every day, depending upon you, the slate can be wiped clean. God takes us every hour of every day, and He's willing to take us by the hand and to lead us out of our enslavement to sin. If we're willing to repent, He's willing to take us out of that curse which we are under. It makes us, in Romans 6, 4, it says we can now walk in newness of life. That's the only way you can walk in newness of life, is to be forgiven by God. Listen, I was listening to the radio as I do on Sunday mornings, and Chuck Swindoll gave me a great illustration of this point. He said, if you go to God in prayer and you ask Him, God, forgive me for that sin again, God's going to say, what sin? Because God has already forgotten about that sin. His love has already erased that sin. All you got to do, listen to me, folks. Maybe you find yourself moving away a little. Stop. Get on your knees and repent. And the Word of God guarantees that your sins are forgiven. Hey, I'm not special. There's times in my life where I get away. But God is so, so good to a sinner, even like me, that He'll always forgive me. Amen?
Amen.
I'm not going to be able to get any further today, but you'll just have to come for the sequel next Sunday. And this is going to take 4 or 5 Sundays. We'll see where it takes us. We do want to thank you for coming this morning. Our praise and worship team is going to come up. And we're going to give the Lord some time to work in our midst, okay? Lord, that there's some here that don't know You as personal Lord and Savior.
So Lord, we take this time not so much to invite, to decide. We take this time, Lord, to see if there's any that are willing to follow. Lord, I'm not into I don't believe you're in the, our church has been making deciders. The churches have been making deciders for decades. It's time to start making disciples. Lord, we just want to make disciples. Lord, as I walk through your church and I see the teachers that you've given us, I see the children that you've blessed us with. I see our older saints so knowledgeable, so skilled in imparting your truth. I see our younger saints, our younger men teaching your word. Lord, truly we are blessed. You've positioned us, Lord, in a place and in a time where we can declare the good news to all. So Lord, if there's anyone here today that desires to follow you, we pray, Lord, your spirit sweep through their heart, touch them in a way that will cause them to proclaim publicly that you're their Lord and their Savior. And Lord, we leave that all up to you. I know it's not by my words that anything like that would happen. It's by your Spirit. If there's anyone here, Lord, in need of counsel, if there's anyone here in need to kneel at the altar and pray, we're going to give that time, Lord. If there's those here, we've had 5 baptisms. Someone that needs to be baptized because they want to display their obedience following you. We don't believe the water saves. We believe it's a picture of our obedience. Whatever the need, Lord, whatever you desire, that's what we desire at this time. So be with your people, Lord, as we express our hearts to you. And we pray this, Lord, in the wonderful Jesus Christ. Amen. Brother Ron.
We would like to thank you for coming this morning and invite you back to our 6:30 service. Let's pray. We thank you that we could be here today. We pray that you would just be with us throughout the day. Just help us to honor you and serve you in all we do and say. Be with us as families, Lord. Strengthen us and help us to be strong. Amen. Amen.
Yeah.